Well, since I'm still on aerobatic, very active pilot, the previous one was the freestyle unknown presentation, if I may say, using the terminology we are using. This one is the known program now. The shiny, the entertaining one. And what I wanted to mention, we are frequently joking with Marcus, this is the shiny bit. But that's not a joke, in fact. That's the way to prepare the future. Innovation and related activities within the agency. It is not only certification. Here you will see, I will start from the top and then go to the various directorates. So how do we prepare ourselves for the new challenges? Early last year, Patrick Key decided really to show and to act on how to prepare the future within the agencies. And we have entered since, let's say, almost 2 years now, a series of changes to be prepared for the future. That's what we have here on the bottom right. It is not a joke. We need to transform the agency in terms of mindset, how to work with industry, how to be prepared for new challenges, new business models, new technologies. This is no joke. Yesterday, we spoke about digital transformation. We spoke about additive manufacturing this morning and so forth. The list is endless, clearly. So we have to put in place into our historical organization, and there is nothing wrong because we have years, decades of very good records together with you. We have to put in place a parallel stream to prepare the future. And that's what Patrick Key started to develop last year in creating what we call this innovation cell. So what is this animal? This is a cross-directorate activity. It's a cross-directorate group with representatives from flight standard, from safety strategy, from certification. Really a small group at management level able to sit down, brainstorm on what are the newcomers, what are the new priorities, what are the challenges we have to work with, how to prepare new competencies, and so forth. So the key vision here is adapt the agency to innovation. It is to create a dynamic of innovation within the agency. But also most important, we spoke, Stéphane, you spoke about it this morning, competence, how to make sure competence is shared within an organization. It is our challenge. So here, how to share innovation knowledge. We have a lot of experts who are working on very fascinating topics. We have to gather this knowledge, those sum of competencies for the benefit of all. So that's really what we have here. Collecting, sharing knowledge and information across domains is vital to our efficient development. And most important, because we are not working in isolation, this innovation cell is to make sure that we support you best. That means support industry on innovation through new means, new tools. Your vision from the agency some years ago was a safety regulator. You are here to produce something, to design something, to develop. We are here to assess and verify that it was right, to summarize. We are not here to work with you as partners on common challenges. What we are targeting now, still having this safety regulator, of course, core business as main business, what we are targeting is to work with you also on preparing the future. In fact, the we need to be prepared for the future is not we, agency. It is we together, you and us. And that's the last bullet here on this slide, to support industry on innovation through various partnerships. And I will show you which kind of partnership we are having. But before, just to show you, how did we organize the agency? Jean-Marc Cluzeau, who is the lead of the innovation cell, has developed an innovation network. It is, of course, a community tool on our website. And since we are talking about new technology, we have to use up-to-date communication tools. On this network, has had a slow start. And since a few months, really now you see a lot of experts exchanging, sharing ideas, views, brainstorming without, I would say, any taboo on not additive manufacturing, because we hear about it every day, but about other topics, AI, about neural network and so forth, in a very open manner. And it is amazing for a safety regulator to see what kind of information we get into this network. So we are really keen, together with Jean-Marc and colleagues, we are really keen having this network because it's a way to get our experts into a new or different communication mode. You don't talk about innovation through emails it does not go very far. You have really to exchange. It's a forum, in fact. Well, that's how we work internally. Well, the objective is quite simple, as we have here. It's to foster the knowledge community. It's really a community, a mindset. It's also to encourage what we call the cross-directorate and cross-domain collaboration. We all have the same issue into our respective organizations. We have, I will not use the keywords, dangerous one, silos, but we have domains. And sometimes domains would have a tendency to work a bit in isolation. For innovation, this should be prevented by all means. We cannot have a domain innovative next to a domain non-innovative. That is nonsense. So we have to make sure that across all domains, we are able to speak openly, share views, and in fact, don't feel to be ashamed or don't be afraid to mention something which may look a bit strange to your colleagues. Just a way to have new ideas on new topics, and maybe out of 10 posts, one will be very interesting. And the experience shows it's working pretty well. And we also organize inside the agency a number of other events, lunchtime lecture, all staff meeting, and so forth, really to develop this new spirit, this new mindset. So, how to work with you, industry, because that's what you're interested in fact. So, I can speak here on behalf of Jean-Marc Cluzeau. We have basically two major tools in the agency. At executive level, we are working on what we call a memorandum of cooperation. It is really a high-level agreement between executives, which gives all of us, you and us, a vision on what we want to commonly develop. A cooperation on whatsoever, AI, a cooperation on drones, I don't know, a buzzword of today, so it can be the case. So how to work between industry, one stakeholder, and us, this will set up the scene at strategic executive level, and then for us, we can implement this vision into various means. In particular, what we call, that's the first sub-bullet in yellow, what we call innovation partnership contracts. That's a very new animal into our landscape, well, not so new anymore because it's more than a year already old. We have quite a few. Some are already completed. I cannot disclose anything about them, of course, because this is innovative, so there are some IPR you will understand. But what I can really comment based on my own experience, because I was part of most of them, is it is a way to drive our experts for the next step. There are still experts from certification, from flight crew, from ops, etc. But here, we have to sit in a room with sometimes a startup with brilliant, bright ideas, very disturbing to us as a safety regulator if we focus, if we stick to our Part 21 mindset. So the question when we launch negotiation for those IPCs is not, it is more how to make it happen. And just a small anecdote, if I may say, at the very early stage of those IPCs, I was in a meeting with a lot of people, and it was amazing. It was pure coincidence. We had the one presenting, and we had a group of experts, another group of experts, and the presentation was fascinating. It was really something quite interesting. And on the right-hand side, I had people who said, it will never work. Okay, then. And on the left side, okay, that's difficult. How can we make it happen? And I'm not joking. It was really the case. It was amazing the way people were distributed. The right-hand side, we have to drive them through the next, I would say, mindset. And on the left, they were already convinced. How to make this happen? It's not easy. We are not prepared. What can we do? And that's what we expect in terms of common benefit, in terms of achievements together with you. So the first one is to drive all of us through this innovative mindset. That means we should be in a brainstorming mode, how to make something happen. Of course, again, I have to put a caveat, we are a safety regulator, so we are targeting certain safety levels, that's clear. But clearly here, alongside this main objective, the other one is for you and for us to learn from each other, to develop, I will not say our knowledge or competencies, but really to develop our common understanding, sometimes common knowledge, on a given high-tech topic. For additive manufacturing, now it's quite on track, but I spoke about neural network, for instance, in the agency some years ago. There were not so many people familiar with neural network. today, we have developed a certain knowledge, I would not say competence, but thanks to a number of discussions in that respect, we have developed a certain culture on neural network. It's just a simple, modest example, but it shows you the benefit of this kind of approach. And of course, we have many other tools, workshop, research cooperation, exchange of experts with industry. Yes, that's something very important. We want to develop exchange of experts, sending some of our experts to you, and vice versa. Again, to exchange knowledge, not only technical, sometimes it can be processes as well. Well, in certification, just to do a bit of advertisement for Rachel's directorate, we had also gone last year through a significant reorganization, and you will find into this new organizational chart all keywords in general aviation, in so CT2, second from the left, in CT3, VTOL, for instance, you have eVTOL, a new concept. This is really something new, how to prepare the future. In general aviation, you have light manned aircraft. Again, here, a lot of work with the next neighbor department on drones, on all those new systems, and many different ones. I have also to mention something. It is not really innovation, but it will facilitate definitely innovation. In the CT4 department, you have a new word, sustainability. Again, here in the new Commission environment, into the new European mindset, we have to keep this in mind and we have to make sure that what we do is sustainable on the long term. So this is something new. It looks simple in terms of organization, but in terms of mindset, in terms of how we manage our experts, it is quite significant. And I should not forget the most important one, of course, my new position here at senior level, which is to make innovation visible and to organize it for the directorate. So, I spoke about the partnership a few seconds ago. Basically, that's what we are looking for. And we get more and more contact with you, so it shows it starts to really become a workable tool. We want really to work on this supply of technical knowledge, but basically, not only addressing novel technologies, but also new business model, as well as new services. And new business models in the new entrants, they are quite sometimes challenging business model to what we do. So this is part of what we have in mind here. It is not using our usual word, the shiny, high-tech, visible part of the system, but it is equally, not to say even more important, those new business models that are the enablers for the high-tech development. So we are also prepared to work on this. And to conclude here, a very important caveat, we had historical tool, the TAC, Technical Advice Contract. This has nothing to do with innovation. TAC is really short term. You have a certification program just about to start. Your design is already well developed, well frozen. You want to have a specific advice on some doubts you may have on this program, then we can talk about a TAC. But this is really very standard certification work. If you talk about the feasibility of something new, a proof of concept, a really new challenging model, then we can go for an IPC because that's what is really important. So we have the graduation, the memorandum, the executive vision, the mission statement for the organizations, how to work together, and then below various tools. And the most important tool, experience starts to show it, is this IPC, Innovation Partnership Contract. So if you have any idea here, do not hesitate to contact Jean-Marc Cluzeau or anybody else from the Innovation Cell. We will be very pleased to tell you more about how we are working on this. Alors, now, we were into a design and certification DOA production workshop. We have not seen many aircraft. You saw one yesterday during Michael's presentation. So, I have a couple of slides now to show you the challenge we are faced with. This, for us, is easy business. It's daily business. We are very well prepared for years, for decades. We know how to certify this. So we could say, historically, no problem. This is a bit more challenging already. That's what we have today on our plate. You may be familiar with some of them. The top left is quite interesting, the PAL-V. The PAL-V is a gyro, so you could say, well, it's not very innovative, but it is also a car. And so that's something which is challenging because they will have, or they should have to comply to comply with aeronautical standards and road standards, and sometimes they are not very compatible. More than electric car, the Stratobus, and so forth, the Lilium, which you know very well, the Aeromobile, and many others. But I took a few examples here to show you yesterday, very well established structures, CS23, 25, 27, and so forth. Today, on top of the previous one, this one. So already here, quite challenging. But then, what we may see, I'm not joking, these are contacts we had, this kind of products, or even this kind of product. Maybe one or two out of those 30 here will survive, or maybe 5 or 10, but in any case, we have to be prepared for the future. This kind of product, you may be familiar with some. Some are flying, some are already. I saw some video. I even was invited once to visit one. I have not yet found the time to go, but I'm sure I will find the time. I'm quite keen to see how the, for instance, the Terra Fugia or some others are really flying in practice. So this is no joke. Some models here are quite challenging to our engineer and pilot mindset, but they are not even more challenging than the one, for instance, the Volocopter or the Lilium, which are already flying today. So in a nutshell, to complete this presentation on innovation, what do we do here? The key word, the starting point was last year, so as I mentioned, creation of this innovation cell by Patrick Key. And this innovation cell has shown to be a good support to all directorate into the agency to prepare ourselves for the future. And with this, I thank you very much for your time. Thank you.
Thanks, Alain. And because of these pictures, you know why he has the most fun job in certification, doing all these nice things. We received one question for you, which is not really something on innovation, but it's an interesting connection.
Aha. That's a good one. We could speak for ages about that. We have in place what we call a continuous process improvement. I will use the quality wording just to make sure that we are on the same page. But now, what we are doing today, and it was part of the presentation, in fact, it is not only about new technology, it is also a new business model and how to get the agency to be better prepared for the future. So, in terms of certification process, well, you had the first idea by Michael yesterday. We are really shaking our regulatory system, the Part 21 light, the GA Task Force. What we call also, nobody has mentioned it, but the net safety benefit. That's a very interesting concept. For a regulator, for a lawyer also, it is a bit challenging. A net safety benefit is you are not considering the full set of certification specification, but you are having an assessment of the end-to-end safety benefit. Will this system, I'm very black and white here, will this system, for instance, save more life than it will cost? It's a bit simplified. But this net safety benefit is for us also a way to allow innovation to implement system which may not comply with 1309 at the latest amendment or D178B and so forth, but which will be of so much help to the pilot or to the crew that the relief will be huge. And the overall net safety benefit will be very positive. So all these kind of initiatives are addressing this question. How to improve our certification process? Definitely, we are on the way. Not only through streamlining the processes, being more efficient. You know that we have an efficiency project in the agency, how to work in a more streamlined, into a more lean process, but also in terms of new mindset. And maybe I'm wrong, but I think the mindset is even more important than the process at our expert level. People have to be really prepared to work with you on how to make something happen, of course, into a given framework. And the given framework, we have to agree on it commonly. And that's going back to the previous presentation on standards. We have to make sure that a standard is mutually acceptable. And then once we have this, we may work with a new mindset, how to make it happen a bit better. But still, historically, like any change, any transformation, still you will see I will use the word legacy or the standard products for years, probably decades. So we have to have two systems, one roaming down and one roaming up to handle them. And that's what we are working on. Alors, I may address this one, yes. We are, and here I speak on behalf of Luc Tilgat, who is the director on the safety strategy. He's working really a lot on developing network with universities and also research institutes. We are, next week I will be in DLR, for instance, for a workshop with most of the German researchers. DLR organized next door to us here an event internal, and we will participate with the DLR management on explaining what we do, what is certification, what are the safety objectives, why do we need a certification, and that's what we are doing here. Well, I will not go through the full list because it would be a bit boring, but I can guarantee you we have a lot of direct contact, even some memorandum of cooperation with a number of research institutes. Luc Tilgat, Jean-Marc Cluzot also are working with universities on developing also PhD programs. All that is process under development, and we are very hopeful that it will soon produce the first result. Alors, I wanted to comment on the last bullet here. This may impact issue of competence, definitely, and that's why we want to work with them. For us, IPCs, more contribution to research, more involvement into university studies, which are very close to research most of the time, PhD programs, all of that are tools to develop our competence and to remain either on top or at least to know what is going on in order to be better prepared for the future and to identify also the necessary needs for, let's say, recruitment or transformation of staff for the next decade. And here with the CECOM, which was presented this morning, we have regular discussion on what are, based on industry feedback, the most important targets for us as a regulator to focus our expertise in terms of transformation or in terms of development.
Okay, thanks a lot, Alain, on the update on innovation.